Hello students of class 11th, how are you? I hope you all are fine. So dear students, let us continue with chapter 7, Birth, written by A.J. Cronin. So let us continue with reading and explanation to this chapter. So as of now, what we have seen in this chapter, is about a person whose name is Andrew. Andrew had just started his practice as an assistant to Dr. Edward Pace. In the beginning of the story, we have seen that Andrew had just returned after spending a disappointing evening with her, with his beloved, with the girl whom he loved. When Andrew reached his clinic, he found Joe Morgan waiting for him. Joe Morgan was waiting for Andrew because his wife was expecting her first child 20 years after she got married. And it was also first case of Andrew. That is why this case was very important for Andrew. Andrew and Joe Morgan both left for street number 12. When Andrew and Joe Morgan reached Joe Morgan's house, Joe Morgan did not go inside. He stayed outside, as it shows that how much worried he was. He could not dare to go inside. He was very much anxious to what is going to happen, as his wife was expecting her first child 20 years after she got married. So that is why it is also very important for Andrew, and as well as it was a big headache for Joe Morgan. So what would be happening after a few hours? Andrew went inside, observed the situation, and concluded that it would take more than 2 hours or so. He found two more women in the room sitting there. One of them was Joe Morgan's mother, and other one was midwife. Midwife, a lady who is trained, to help in delivery. So we can also call nurse here. Okay. Joe Morgan's wife thought Andrew would say it would take much time and he would leave, but it did not happen. Andrew did not leave. Andrew also assured the lady that he would not leave, and she prepared a cup of tea, and Andrew was taking the tea and thinking about what happened with Christine, his beloved. And also I was thinking about failures of some marriages. So he thought of two or three persons whose marriages were a big failure, whose married life was not married life were not happy. So he thought about them, he was thinking about them. He was also thinking about Dr. Edward Pace, how he devoted to a woman and woman cheated him. So all these things, he was, you know, he could not take a decision that whether, you know, getting married would make him happy or not. Because he had a lot of examples of people, of different people who were not happy after getting married. Okay? So, he was thinking about all these things. So, let's see what happened next in the story. So, today I am going to read page number 67. Okay? I am going to read and explain page number 67. So you all are requested to take out your book and open your book at page number 67. Some hard words and their meanings I made you write in my last video, and I hope you all must have written those words and their meanings. Okay, students, so let us begin. When Andrew was thinking all this, so suddenly he was called by the woman. Man said not to give her the chloroform if it would harm the baby. She was awful set upon the child, Dr. Paul. She said the lady, the old lady informed her he should not give chloroform to Sushan if the chloroform would harm the baby. So the old lady informed Andrew that Sushan said so. She was awful set upon the child, Dr. Batch. Her old eyes warmed at a sudden thought. So the old lady's eyes, you know, warmed at the sudden thought, because, you know, she was very experienced lady, and she thought that the doctor was going to give chloroform to Sushan. So that is why he stopped the doctor by saying that Sushan said not to give her chloroform if it would harm the baby. She added in her low tone, "We are all fancy." So in her low tone further she added that "we also want so." So she said, not only Sushan, we also want so. If chloroform would harm the child, so you should not give chloroform to Sushan. It won't do any harm, the anesthetic. So Andrew said it won't do, he collected himself with an effort. Then Andrew, as he was thinking all about his spoiled evening, so now he collected himself with an effort. It won't do any harm, the anesthetic. He said it won't do any harm, it is only anesthetic. Anesthetic means, you know, a substance that is you know, given during operation to stop the pain. Okay, so a substance that includes, you know, insensitivity in to pain. He said kindly, "They will be all right." He said they both, mother and child, will be all right. Here the nurse's voice was heard calling from the top landing. So now the nurse was calling Andrew from the top landing. Andrew glanced at the clock, which now showed 3:30. Andrew looked at the clock and it was showing half past 3. So it was half past 3 o'clock. He rose and went up to the bedroom. Then Andrew rose as he was sitting beside the fire and he was taking tea. Then Andrew rose and he went to the bedroom, which was upstairs. He perceived that he might now begin his work. Now he thought that now it is the time when he should start his work. An hour elapsed. So an hour passed. It was a long, harsh struggle. So it was a great struggle. Then the first streaks of dawn strayed past the broken edges of the blind. The child was born lifeless. Then now it was, you know, about to get morning. So it was nearly the time of morning. Now the poet says that now the streaks of dawn strayed past. Now the dawn was ending. Now it was the morning was going to start. Okay, so the broken edges of blind, the child was born lifeless. So at this point, when it was about to get morning, then child was born and lifeless, and the child was lifeless. The child was dead. So it was a big challenge for Andrew. It was the first case of his life, and when the child was born, it was dead. So really, you can imagine, so how shocking it was for Andrew. As he gazed at the still form, of a shiver of horror passed over Andrew. So when Andrew gazed at the still form, at the dead child, a shiver of horror passed over Andrew. Then he started trembling. After all that he had promised, his face heated with his own exertions, chilled suddenly. After all that he had promised that everyone would be okay. So his face heated with his own exertion. So now his own tiredness, his, you know, face could be seen on his face. Tiredness could be seen on his face. Chilled suddenly. So his face, was very tired. So a tension, we can say, okay, could be seen. A shocking expression could be seen on his face when he saw the child, the lifeless child. He hesitated, torn between his desire to attempt resuscitate the child. So he hesitated, torn between his desire to attempt to resuscitate the child and his obligation towards the mother, who was herself in a desperate state. Now he could not understand. He was in a dilemma. He could not understand. First, he should do something to revive the child from unconsciousness, or he should do anything to revive the mother, who was also, was also unconscious. So both are here, the child as well as the mother, both were unconscious. So he was undecided. So he was in dilemma between he should see what happened to the child, how he could revive the child, or he could revive the mother, because both of them were unconscious. So that is why he was in a dilemma. So resuscitate, I made you write yesterday, revive someone from unconsciousness. The dilemma was so urgent, he did not solve it consciously. And for solving this dilemma, he did not have much time. Okay? Blindly, instinctively, he gave the child to the nurse and turned his attention to the Susan Morgan, who now lay collapsed. Then he gave the child, he handed over the child to the nurse and he paid his attention, he turned his attention to the Susan Morgan, who was laying there unconsciously collapsed. Almost pulseless and not yet out of the ether upon her side, still she was unconscious. She was not out from the effect of ether which Andrew gave her to make anesthetic, for anesthetic. Okay, so the anesthesia which was given by the Andrew, it was ether, and she was still in the influence of that ether. His haste was desperate, a frantic race against her ebbing strength. Now, suddenly, it was a great rush. It was his emotion. His emotion or quality now gradually decreasing. He could not understand what he should do. So here also his learnings, his quality also, ebbing means, you know, gradually decrease. So it was like, you know, decreasing her, his strength. So frantic race, her ebbing strength. Sorry, once again this line better. His haste was desperate, a frantic race against her, yes, ebbing strength, as the woman was gradually, she was decreasing her strength. So that is why he was in a hurry to revive the lady. It took him only an instant to smash a glass ampoule and inject the medicine. So it took him only an instant. Suddenly, very, you know, hurriedly, he broke the glass ampoule. Glass ampoule means, you know, glass capsule in which medicines for syringes is kept. So that is ampoule, from where with the help of syringes, from where doctors, you know, take the that liquid. Okay, so that part is called ampoule, capsule. Okay, the capsule which carries the liquid for syringe. Then students, he hurriedly filled his syringe with the, yes, that the medicine. Then he flung down the hypodermic syringe and worked unsparingly to restore the flaccid woman. Then he flung down the hypodermic. Hypodermic means relating to the region immediately beneath the skin. So he hurriedly he gave the syringe and worked upspringly to restore the flaccid woman. Generously he started working to restore that lifeless woman. To restore that lifeless woman. So Andrew started working very fast. after injecting the lady, now after a few minutes of feverish effort, her heart strengthened. So after a few minutes of a great effort, the heart of the lady now strengthened. He saw that he might safely leave her. Now he saw that he could leave that lady safely. Now she was out of danger. He swung round in short sleeves, his hair sticking to his damp brow. So now he swung round his short sleeves and his hair sticking to the damp brow. How his hair was sticking to the damp brow. So he with his shirt sleeve he swung round. Where's the child? Then he took a turn and asked. He was completely exhausted. Okay, he was sweating fully. And then he asked, where's the child? After reviving the lady, after getting her injected, when he thought that she was now out of danger, then he suddenly turned to the nurse and asked her, where was the child? The midwife made a frightened gesture. At this, the gesture which was full of fear. She had placed it beneath the bed, because considering the child dead, she placed the child under the bed. In a flash, Andrew knelt down. So suddenly, in a flash, very fast pace, hurriedly Andrew knelt down, fishing amongst the sodden newspapers below the bed. He pulled out the child. Looking for the child in saturated with liquid, that is sodden newspapers, saturated with liquids. Okay, they are soaked through the water. So among those wet newspapers, so he was looking for the child and he pulled out the child. A boy, perfectly formed. The child, who the newly born baby, he was a boy and perfectly formed. The limp, warm body was white and soft tallow. So this body was very flexible, and it was white. It was like a soft, like tallow. Tallow means the hard fat of animals melted and used to make soap, candles, etc. It is given in your book also, the meaning of tallow. The cord hastily slashed lay like a broken stem, the flexible string. So when a child is born, a flexible string could be seen. You must have also seen that on the stomach, that flexible string which is cut after a baby is born. After a baby is born, so that flexible string is cut. Okay, so the cord hastily slashed lay like a broken stump. That part was, it was like a broken stump. The skin was a lovely texture. The skin of the boy was of lovely texture, smooth and tender. So the skin of the boy was smooth and tender. The head lolled on the thin neck, and the head of the boy was, lolling like this. It was very flexible because the child was lifeless. The limb seemed boneless, and the limb of the boy seemed boneless. It was boneless. So the students, on this page we have seen how the baby was born जो मॉर्गन्स वाइफ एक्सपेक्टिंग हर फर्स्ट चाइल्ड सो 20 ईयर्स आफ्टर शी गॉट मैरिड बट शी गेव बर्थ टू अ चाइल्ड विच वॉज लाइफलेस एंड इट वॉज द फर्स्ट केस इन एंड्रयूज लाइफ सो हाउ इट चेंज द होल कोर्स ऑफ एंड्रयूज लाइफ सो वी विल गेट टू नो इट वॉज द फर्स्ट केस ही हैड टू हैंडल एंड द चाइल्ड वॉज बॉर्न लाइफलेस बट एंड्रयू डिड नॉट गिव अप ही टुक आउट द चाइल्ड नाउ एंड विच वॉज थ्रोन अंडर द बेड by the nurse, by the midwife, considering it was a dead child. Now he took out and saw that the child was lifeless, it was white, it was very flexible, okay. So he was examining the child and examining the reason for being the child lifeless. He did not give up, he did not consider the child lifeless and threw it away, no, he did not do it. Still, he had some hope. So, students, now we will see how this incident changed his course of life. It was first case and how beautifully he handled this case. Yes, he made the child alive. In the coming paragraphs, you will get to know how Andrew made the child alive. It is really interesting. He, you know, used a special method. A special method which was used by a doctor. He remembered that method and he used that method and made the child alive. So let's read and come to know. Now turn your book at page number 68. Okay. Page number 68. Still kneeling, Andrew stared at the child with a haggard frown. Haggard means, you know, looking exhausted and unwell. Haggard means looking exhausted and unwell. Okay, so collectively you can haggard frown means here. Okay, haggard frown means here looking exhausted and unwell. Okay, so still kneeling, Andrew stared at the child and child with the exhausted and unwell. He was still exhausted and unwell. He looked at the child. The whiteness meant only one thing, asphyxia, pallida. So he examined that the whiteness meant only one thing. The child was suffering with asphyxia. Pallida, so it's a kind of disease, pallida, it is given in a book, the meaning of this disease, suffocation or unconsciousness condition caused by lack of oxygen and excess of carbon dioxide in blood, accompanied by paleness of skin, weak pulse and loss of reflexes. So it was because of lack of oxygen. So the child was suffering with, you know, lack of oxygen. So that is why he was white with this disease, asphyxia and pallida. And his mind, unnaturally tense, raced back to a case he once had seen in the Samaritan, it's a place, okay. So, you know, he recalled a case, he remembered a case which he had seen in Samaritan. So, such case he had witnessed in Samaritan. So, he thought about that case. okay, and to the treatment that had been used. So he suddenly thought of that treatment, that case which happened, which took place in Samaritan, and he had witnessed that case, and also he started thinking about the treatment which was used. Instantly he was on his feet. So now he was on his feet. So now suddenly, you know, he got some hope. He had some hope that he would make the child alive. He could make the child alive. It's all about today's video. In the next video, we will discuss more about this chapter. So thank you for watching. See you tomorrow.